Yes, thank you so much, Rosa. Thanks for the organizers for having me here. This is an absolutely gorgeous place. I'm truly looking forward to the next couple of days. I will be presenting today is a line of work that is done, which is at the heart of this joint initiative that we're having with Rosa and Jairo and the wonderful colleagues. And it has something to do with how you manipulate systems with strain. I have plenty of wonderful collaborators. I won't read them to you, but if you go through them, you will find that more than half of them are experimentalists for this specific problem. So this talk will be my own perspective of joint collaborations with experimental colleagues, which will therefore cover a significantly broader range than what maybe a usual theorist talk might look like. I think this might be appropriate for this audience and to stimulate some interesting discussions. The work where I will contribute, my own work is based upon is on these two classes of systems, arm-based systems and response and hallucinates. you said half an hour, right? So then, good. Mm-hmm. So, good, very good. Because the nicest part is at the end, so I'm worried. This talk is 1 hour. We can meet halfway, right? So this is, I don't need an hour. So that's, yeah. I'm gonna, okay, whatever. I mean, I don't need that much time. Right. So you experimentalists, what you guys are doing usually is you're having a material in front of you and you want to learn something about it. And what you do is you kick it. With whatever tool you find is most appropriate is kicking and whatever your hammer is. But we usually perturb a system when we want to look at it. And of course, when we start discussing it, then say applying a magnetic field, an electromagnetic field is equally beautiful, right? It's a frequent approach that we are doing. Suppose we stick with the magnetic field, what we do is we can do lots of things. It works so efficiently because we break very well-defined symmetries, rotation symmetry or time reversal symmetry in the context of a magnetic field because it's an axial vector. We know how it communicates at leading or at subleading order with degrees of freedom and so forth. So what we will be looking at is the impact of elastic properties or changing elastic properties. Hence, stress will be our magnetic field, if you wish so. And stress is a symmetric second rank tensor, and it has its own beauty, right? It breaks rotational symmetries in a very well-defined way, and we can learn something about broken rotational symmetries. But also, it just couples to the volume itself, which is a very, very powerful tool to learn something about a system. But then every second rank tensor talks to every other second rank tensor or something that basically transforms like it, like spin quadruples. Hence, we have an efficient way to look into the material, to kick it, if you wish so, with strain devices that have been developed all over the world in different approaches and perfection. So, and just as this is introductory, I mean, we have all kinds of ways by doing this, we can change the volume, which for the strain tensor then means just its trace. We can do uniaxial strain or we can do shear strain, and they are typically volume conserving, yet they change the symmetry. And in all of these objects, if you take one of those, say specifically transforming strain objects, we can couple to order, other type of order. And there are basically two very, very important cases that one wants to distinguish. One is in couples directly to the order parameter of that order, bilinear. What it really means is that if I do squeeze in that very well-defined way, I am actually inducing that order. Because if you bilinearly couple, you always immediately induce that order. It's inevitable. The other one, which is a little bit weaker, but is equally beautiful, is when you couple to the energy density of that order parameter, so the square of the order parameter. And The famous examples are here, magnetic states, piezoelectric transition. What we will be looking at is a strain tuned Lipschitz transition in Swanson-Roussinet. And at the end of the day, I will claim to you that we can use these trickeries to nail down the pairing state of Swanson-Roussinet. But before we get there, we want to talk about this bilinear coupling. So the famous example in this context is a transition that is first order in nature generically and changes the volume of the system. So historically, chromium-doped vanadium 203 was an important example where we at finite temperatures go from an insulating, meaning temperature dependency of the resistivity is as a negative derivative rather than a positive one. We go from insulators to metal state to a first order transition that terminates at a critical endpoint. And this type of behavior was early on already understood that A, the volume changes at this transition. So whatever the order parameter could be in a MOD language, the natural one is some microscopic degree that characterizes the modness, and that you would characterize the state by essentially an Ising transition. And there are so many experts on this field here in the audience that I can't even mention them all, but one thing is clear, when you are a naive person and you think of an Ising transition with a critical endpoint, then you typically think of the liquid vapor critical endpoint. And as we will see, there are some analogies, the Ising class, but there are vast and important differences because this Ising degree of freedom lives in a crystalline solid with a finite shear modulus. So therefore, while you can use this analogy wonderfully with the Ising class, you need to be aware that this Ising order parameter communicates with the lattice in a very, very profound way. So here are wonderful experimental data that I think are even nicer than what we teach our students about the van der Waals gas of the liquid vapor transition, just by the beauty of the color plot for the vanadium O3 and here from Kazuchi Kanoda's group of the chloride-based organic charge transfer salt, where you can see the jump in the conductance, if you want, so the terminating at the critical endpoint in both cases, and you can see how, for example, transport is reflecting this transition. There are many more sophisticated measurements on this transition. I'll get to them right in a second. The important message here is, and we will see different examples, but I thought I should start with this one because it will be repeated, I think, and discussed in subsequent talks. The beauty is, if I have my Ising order parameter in some Ising field theory, continuum or discrete, whatever it is, and I have this bilinear coupling, so the volume change couples to this MOD order parameter, if you wish so, then I also need to take into account the elastic degrees of freedom of the system. And if you eliminate those, then you find that this coupling to the elastic degree of freedom, to constantly having to change the volume if I do change the order parameter, gives me something that up until then, I think only theorists were discussing, namely infinite range interaction. So every site in the sample, the Ising degree of freedom, talks to every other one with exactly the same strength of interaction because it's a global volume, this finite shear modulus that communicates with them. We get an infinite range interaction. This is not divergent because it's one over the volume, but has the exact same extensivity than usual. But what it implies is that there will be mean field behavior at the critical endpoint. So the elastic degrees of freedom force it to behave like in a mean field. This was first pointed out in the 70s. There's a beautiful work for two-dimensional systems by David Nelson in the 90s. And for many of us clarifying, including me clarifying work here by Sahir, Bartas, and Marcus Das. And these data here, which I suspect at least we might be glancing at later on again, because Elena is here and Michael is here. The mean field behavior was indeed observed in the thermodynamic, in the measurement of thermodynamic degrees of freedom. And we have here this yellow regime where indeed mean field type of behavior was observed. So we have elastic degrees of freedom change the nature of the universality class of this transition. This is important, but it gets more complicated, which is data from Jens, who is also Jens Müller, also in Frankfurt, who looked at the dynamics of this transition. And the dynamics shows us that there's typical slowing down with a essentially diverging length scale. This infinite range mean field model is not supposed to have that problem. So it clearly says there is more going on. Maybe in the thermodynamics, we get a fair understanding on the mean field level, but the dynamics of the system is much more complicated. My strong feeling is it's unresolved, this problem, at least as far as I understand it, that every disorder, every piece of disorder in the system acts for this Ising degree of freedom like a random magnetic field, or the pseudo Ising degree of freedom. So we have a random field Ising model, and this is the worst disorder you can get, random field disorder. Often we have, say, interactions between Ising spins that are random, and if they're strong enough, we get spin blasts. In systems that are actually tending to order, they're never really all that strong. But here we have a random field, which is a much more dramatic way of interfering with. I think this is responsible for this trip going down. It is, I think, as far as from the theory point of view, it is not an understood point, maybe you correct me. So there is work to be done in this regime, in particularly as far as the dynamics are concerned. There's another phase transition where we are coupling linearly, so where the order parameter couples linearly to strain, but now to shear strain. Not volume changing strain, but shear strain that keeps the volume intact. And this is happening in the iron-based superconductors at this much discussed pneumatic transition. The order parameter here is essentially some internal degree of freedom that says my right direction is different than my forward direction. Rotation by 90 degrees is ruined, and then every strain that also changes its sign by the same 90-degree rotation will couple bilinearly to it. I have invested lots of energy in giving a microscopic picture of what that is about, but I don't want to get into this at the moment. Important is that it is, in its nature, much similar to what the behavior of the MOD transition is, because both have the coupling order parameter, whatever it is, it's a different one here, it changes the rotation symmetry. I think so there could not be a critical endpoint because it changes the symmetry. And this is now a shear strain, not a volume changing strain. So in the pneumatic transition, as many of you might know, there's this tiny little sliver here above the magnetic transition. There is an immediate consequence that you can draw from this. If you're coupling like this, if you're coupling shear strain to Ising degree of freedom, then you can make a rigorous statement. You can't make too many in this game, but there is one. Namely that, because this is xy, the elastic constant C66 gets renormalized by the fluctuations of this object. And the Ising susceptibility of this Ising degree of freedom, pneumatic degree of freedom here, when it diverges, it means the elastic constant goes to zero. And these are here early measurements, in fact, by David Mandras and the group at Tennessee, where we have this enormous softening of the elastic constant in the iron-based systems as you approach, as you go down in temperature. So there are much better data that have been taken in the meantime, but the softening that is due to the, in our interpretation, increase of this susceptibility is really responsible here for critical elastic degree of freedom coupling to critical internal pneumatic freedom by linear. So you can, our personal story in this context was that the Ising degree of freedom is the weight of modulated spin density wave that propagates along the x direction or along the y direction and appropriately squared. So this is a pi zero or zero pi ordering, but this is too much microscopy, but important is spin degrees of freedom can transform just like such a second rank tensor. If there are spin degrees of freedom, you can probe the spin dynamics with an NMR experiment. You can probe the elastic degrees of freedom with, for example, resonant ultrasound or whatever method you wish to take, and there should not be independent degrees of freedom. And that's a work we undertook with Christoph Meingast and Anna Böhmer and my dear friend Rafael Fernandez a number of years ago. And you can deduce the elastic constant from NMR data. These are the dots. And the lines are the measured elastic constants. And there are exactly one fit parameter in the system that is the same for all of them. What it tells us is that indeed we have some way of understanding how, for example, this second rank tensor communicates with the elastic strain and how elastic properties are knowing something about, for example, this specific case, magnetic fluctuations. The story that I told you earlier that we have an infinite range interaction is different here. But we still get long range interactions, actually of dipolar character. They are 1/r to the cubed, which still makes the system mean field like, but only above a certain dimension. Then you can ask the question, when is this mean field? And one can make, using some RG arguments, the rigorous statement that whenever you see softening, that's also exactly the regime where you would expect this mean field behavior to occur, which makes perfect sense. You have an internal degree of freedom that couples to the lattice whenever the lattice gets soft. And the lattice causes this to have long range interaction. So you can make a consistent statement about these two states. And this is what is quite nice. These were the predictions that this is not something you should ignore, this crossover. And we saw this also in the organics. We saw this big yellow blob around the critical endpoint. This is not a tiny little final effect. It's an important effect in all these systems that are coupling strongly to the lattice. So maybe I skip this and come back to this disorder story, because it is equally prevalent here, where we have in, for example, NQR measurements in these iron-based systems. These are iron selenium, I think, under pressure. When you go down in temperature, you get a significant broadening of your NQR line. The system, upon decreasing the temperature, gets broader and broader lines without actually ordering. So here we have the splitting of the lines. This is exactly where our rotational symmetry breaking condition should take place, but we have significant broadening in a wide regime above this, and there's even some type of scaling behavior of the NQR line loops here by a number of NMR groups observed. And of course, as I mentioned earlier, every disorder locally prefers maybe this orientation over that orientation, if it only is located at a position that by itself breaks rotation symmetry. So we did a little model calculation here with Anna Böhmer and Macquarie-Julien and Paul Getzky, where we just showed that this behavior that has been seen in several NMR experiments can be very naturally understood as basically the broadening due to the Edwards-Anderson parameter that you would have in any glassy system, because these systems are so disordered. The random field Ising model is anywhere glassy, if you wish to, because you cannot get rid of it by symmetry. So you can have the Edwards-Anderson order parameter, and you get this type of scaling behavior very naturally. What it tells us is that the effective pneumatic coupling changes in the system, but the disorder doesn't. And what you're seeing are local droplets that are ordering pneumatically, and decreasing temperature, you're just accumulating more because the system gets more and more responsive. The dynamics of such an elastic degree of freedom can be seen, as usual, using Raman. This is precisely the probe that allows you to see a second rank tensor type fluctuation. Because it is Raman active, that's what it does. And you can do quantitative analysis. This is work we did here with Rudy Huckel in this context. But the reason why I'm mentioning it, because you may then ask the question, what happens after all these are superconductors? If I have, say, an elastic mode that dynamically is visible in the system in the superconducting state. In the superconducting state, you're opening a gap. And this spectrum here changes. And there are wonderful experiments by Gilles Bloomberg and collaborators, where as we are here in the phase diagram of one of those iron-based systems and approaching at low temperatures, the state of pneumatic order, there's a sharp peak rising at low temperatures. Only when we enter the superconducting state, normal state. In the normal state, it just looks like what we've seen here earlier. And these systems, in the superconducting state, we get a sharp resonance that establishes at low temperatures and when we approach the nematic transition. And there is a deep understanding of bound state formation in the superconducting state that was basically triggered by the magnetic resonance mode that, for example, Bernhard Kaimer and collaborators so beautifully explored. This is the nematic analog of this one, something that we worked out in a collaboration with Indrani Paul and Jan Galay, where you, in the superconducting state, form an excitonic bound state because you open up a gap. And therefore, you can, as usual, form a bound state, and that bound state then forms inside the gap and is only there because you open the gap and you are not able anymore to dampen it. So what do we learn from this? That the Bogoliubov quasi-particles of the superconducting state in these materials very, very strongly couple to those nematic degrees of freedom. Otherwise, you wouldn't have a sufficiently strong interaction to give you such a bound state. So this was my little discussion that I wanted to have first on the issue that what happens when you have an order parameter that by itself couples to strain, but it does so bilinearly. So you induce the strain and you get the order parameter. You change the volume and you can force a system into a metallic state, for example. Now we want to look at what appears to be the easier, the simpler, the less the conspicuous case, namely where you only couple to the square, right? And near any transition, any power that is higher means for a small order parameter, it should be less important. So therefore, let's look at this case. And what we want to look at in particular is strontium ruthenate, where of course, Andy McKenzie, Clifford Dix, and all the wonderful collaborators have done so such great work. And we will also see some work from Andre as we move on. So, This is the material, strontium ruthenate, which is a highly anisotropic material with a three-sheeted Fermi surface in the unstrained situation, where our attention will be on the so-called quasi-two-dimensional object that is the lab jargon language is the gamma band. So this is a kind of roundish thing here. Why is this interesting? Because when you pull or push more precisely in one uniaxial direction, you can change this electronic structure. And you can change it to a degree that the experimentalists were capable of moving this point up here. I'm closer, so you see this point here, right? This end. Moving it towards the Brillouin zone boundary where there is a Van Hoff singularity. And what it means is that we are now having the Fermi energy right at the Van Hoff singularity for a strongly anisotropic system. There is at least a logarithmic singularity of the system. You can estimate the temperature below which you really see that it's three-dimensional is about a Kelvin. So this is a very, very anisotropic system. There are interesting reasons why this is the case. I don't want to get into this. But what, of course, the main impact of this beautiful work from 2017 was that if you do this, and to strain the system, the superconducting transition temperature goes from 1.5 to 3.5 Kelvin. So this is a big effect. If we could do this with the cuprates, we would have a room temperature superconductor if we could increase it by about 2.5 times the unstrained value of the transition temperature. So, and this is at least was speculated, and I think we know with certainty now, the strain value where you are crossing this Van Hoff singularity. So this is at least something one shouldn't be entirely ignoring in these systems. And maybe it can reveal us something that we didn't know before. So let me play a little bit of a theorist game in this context. So this is, if I only focus my attention on the gamma band, the one that we've just discussed, this would be its densities of states. The reasonable type binding parameterization of photo emission data is a blue curve. If I now strain it, I split those Van Hoff points. And because I'm breaking the symmetry, I only strain in one direction, not in the other direction. I don't have four Van Hoff points, or basically two symmetry equivalent ones. They would probably scatter into one another and cause a density wave instability. We only have one. So this point now crosses is at the Fermi energy. So we have this tiny little peak, and you would at first glance expect there isn't much happening here, right? So this is one out of many bands. In the top 10 electron volts of the system, there are about 10 bands of a large bandwidth. And what we're doing is we're changing maybe the density states by a factor of, I don't know, 1.5. And it's only a log. So logs is not even a real function. So why would this be something interesting? So if you kind of make a little model for this one, we say, well, my electronic specific heat or the entropy of the system is typically linear, but now I get when this temperature scale here is zero that is associated with tuning me to this point, then I get an additional log just because it's as a log, right, from the density states. The same statement would be true if I could produce by whatever means a marginal Fermi liquid that is strain tuned. But everything I'm saying, because it's so phenomenological, would be identical, in fact. But this we have here a very, very concrete and specific example. So now what I can do is I, of course, get from this result when I, at a finite temperature, I see that the entropy has a maximum right at this point. That is not entirely surprising, but we will actually see experiment that verifies that. And when I go down in temperature, it will be more pronounced, this S over T. But now I can do what one naturally do in thermodynamics. I have an entropy. I can integrate it up to a temperature independent constant that might include some background elastic constant. I get the free energy. And if I take the second derivative back to strain, I get the elastic constant. And trust me, this is a doable calculation. What you find is that the elastic constant gets a divergent contribution that has negative in sign. What it means is the system must give before temperature is even reached at peak zero. The system, the lattice is not stable. You can't go down arbitrarily low in temperature having such an entropy and expect the system will be happy. It will be naturally unstable, which to me at least was surprising. You know, this, I mean, any interaction in the system will have to do something to the system. We of course know there's something happening to the system. It becomes a superconductor. Whether this is the reason, I don't know. But it is inevitable for this to happen. We have an inevitable lattice instability in this problem. Hmm? Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, of course, first what we actually did is we used the density of states, we did the fitting, we do the integrals and so forth, and you get precisely this. I just thought for the purpose of this presentation, but this is precisely what you get. It's inevitable what you get when you have a log diverging density of states, you just get this entropy. No, it wasn't like this. There were long, boring calculations going on. We didn't know what it meant. We looked at it for weeks, and then we get, oh, it's actually simple. So yeah. So you know, it's always the other way than what you think people are trying to tell you. So, but I find this quite amazing that this sign here is non-negotiable. This is ultimately thermodynamically unstable, and so at some temperatures this will be large enough to compensate for this term. Now, of course, we discussed this a great deal with our friends in Dresden, and Cliff Hicks and Hilary Node, they had actually already started doing a wonderful experiment on the elastic constant of this material of strontium ruthenate, and I got their permission yesterday to show the data. And so here we have at 40 Kelvin, the Young's modulus of the system, and this is at 4 Kelvin. And we are talking, this goes from 170 to 150 gigapascal. This is, one more time, we're having one tiny little density of states sitting up there, one out of 10 bands that are in the relative vicinity that would contribute to the electron pressure, and we are getting a significant reduction, here you see it again, of the elastic modulus. This would be when we are at ambient pressure, at ambient strain, This is when we are at the Van Hoff point in the system. So we see that there is, in my view, a dramatic softening of the system going on. So how do we have to think about it? My understanding of the stability of a metal is you have electron pressure that always wants to go away. And you have Coulomb interaction, they always want to collapse the system, and they balance each other. And this happens to be when we let this punch the wall of the Bohr radius because of the Coulomb interaction. But the pressure of the electrons that is being exerted here on the system really doesn't come only from the states on the Fermi energy. It comes from all states that have appreciable bandwidths, so that their energy is sensitive to the lattice constant. So core electrons might screen just the net charge, but every electronic state that has a finite bandwidth. And of course, Rother must know much better because she actually does those calculations. But this is my hand-waving argumentation that you get such a significant reduction is very interesting. We have done some significant modeling. I don't want to bother you with this one, that there is some non-linear because we're doing this under stress, non-linear Poisson effect that makes it so large. But important is there's an instability. And once we thought about this, you can actually go and make a little bit more rigorous statements, because what we've just said was looking at the entropy. And we said there was a logarithm. But in principle, let's look at the generic quantum critical point. And let's make only one assumption, that this quantum critical point can be tuned with strain. Then basically there has to be hyperscaling relationship of the entropy with temperature and strain relative to the critical strain. This is the case when I have the quantum critical point with hyperscaling. It is tuned by strain. Now I can do the exact same calculation. I integrate the result and get the free energy, take twice two derivatives to get the elastic constant, and you find that there is an elastic constant that will necessarily diverge if this combination of exponents is obeyed. Something like the quantum Harris criterion, if you wish so. Because there's a D plus Z Harris criterion is something to do with sensitivity to disorder. And of course, I have a wonderful colleague, Marcus, who said, yeah, we thought about this. And there is a very nice paper from Zacharias, Rush, and Garth, where based on epsilon expansion, a statement fully consistent with this one was already obtained. So what it tells us is, if the entropy has a maximum, which means the second derivative is the scaling function, the maximum is strain. The second derivative of the scaling function is negative, then we must have such an instability. It's a very strong statement. What does it mean? It means the description of that critical state without honest to God treatment of the elastic degrees of freedom is illegal. It has to flow to some new fixed point that is governed by the elastic degrees of freedom as an honest to God player in the electronic system. So then, of course, everything relied on the fact that the entropy had to be maximal. I think it's plausible to make the statement, but it's something that you can actually measure. And this is a measurement that you do, again, super discussions I had recently with the Dresden crowd, and also when I was visiting Ian Fisher at Stanford, is the elastocaloric effect. The elastocaloric effect is when you adiabatically change strain, when you do it under adiabatic conditions, you change the temperature. So this change in the temperature, this strain adiabatically taken with usual thermodynamic identities is the ratio of the entropy derivative back to strain by the heat capacity. So this tells us, therefore, something about the sign of the strain derivative of the entropy. If you just under adiabatic condition measure a temperature change upon changing strain. The experiment that was pioneered initially by Matthias Ikeda and Ian Fisher and carried out beautifully by Yu Shengli in Dresden is essentially that you strain your system, and then you have a little AC strain on top of this, and you see lock in the AC temperature variation. So here are the data where we have what I'm showing you is this quantity gamma. This is ultimately the so-called greenizing parameter also. And these data here would give you something that's temperature independent, that's near zero strain. That's precisely what happens here, a temperature independent value if you have an ordinary thermoliquid with a flat density state. But if you go away from this and you see this fine structure here, where you have a zero crossing of the derivative of the entropy, which means the entropy is a maximum. And slope going down tells us it's a maximum. And this is the theory, and that's precisely the theory that Rosier wanted us to do. Honest to God, density of states, take the photo emission type binding parameterization, get an idea what the strain variation of the hopping parameters are, and so forth and so on. And then this is the theory. And there's one feature, as you can observe, that we didn't catch with this simple theory, which is here. And this is actually a magnetic transition in the phase diagram of the strain. There was already one point earlier measured by muon experiment in the samples. So what we see here is the entropy maximum. We see that there's a deviation from this Greenhausen scaling near this Lipschitz point, and there's a magnetic transition. And at least this here tells us that really this structure here is our understanding that this is due to a van Hoffe point that we are crossing, a Lipschitz point, is the correct one. I mean, this is not the axis here. I keep telling my collaborators we should actually put the same label here again, so nobody thinks these theories are giving arbitrary units. These are actually the same units. So the implications of this, when you have such large compressive fluctuations that give rise to the significant softening in this system, and these are long wavelengths, forward scattering fluctuations, it won't affect much the resistivity. It is T squared like in a thermoliquid, and there's one log you accumulate, and you have to think hard about, but that's what you get. However, there's another transport quantity that is not affected or not suppressed by forward scattering, which is the thermal conductivity. And the clear result that we obtained in here in the work with Veronica Stangier and Eris Berg was that the thermal conductivity at that Lipschitz point actually goes like T to the 3 halves, if I write it like an electrical resistivity. So what it tells us is that the Wiedemann-Franz law at this transition must be broken down. This has not been seen, that our prediction in this context, simply because these are these compressive fluctuations that we know now are there because they are responsible for the suppression also of the elastic modulus. And of course, something that I already speculated earlier, if you know we have additional fluctuations right where TC is largest, at least it's tempting to speculate that it's not entirely irrelevant for superconductivity. So with all of this, we can ask the next question and ask whether we can say anything about the pairing state of strontium-ruthenate with the help of strain tuning the material. And so what I've done here is, and I will torture you with this now for a little while, is to collect all possible pairing states of strontium-ruthenate that are there if we ignore full differential type states or any broken translation there. So we have either a singlet or a triplet. And if we have a singlet, it can be S wave, it can be G wave, it can be D wave, like in the recuperates, it can be D wave rotated, and then there are three possible realizations that are combinations of, say, DXZ and DYZ. They transform into one another. They can break time reversal symmetry, which is a chiral state, or they can be helical, which means it's so-called nematic superconductor in the superconducting state, the rotation symmetry. And all of these states, except for the trivial one, have counterparts in the triplet channel, of course. And we go through them now in some detail just to get familiarized. What are the options here? Well, this is clear. A1G, this is S wave pair. I think already in 98, there is a, to my taste, a breakthrough work experimentally, namely by this group of experimentalists who demonstrated that normal non-magnetic scattering kills superconductivity. And it tells us this is better be an unconventional superconductor. So this is the upper course of Borkhoff line. This is what we would expect for magnetic pairing if it was a conventional superconductor, but it's not a magnetic pair impurities, these are the non-magnetic impurities. And so the common wisdom says that this ought to be anything but S-wave. It is a dangerous statement to some extent. There could be accidental nodes with large of sign changes going on. So that being that is excluded, I would think this really tells us this is an unconventional superconductor. In a way, you can use this as a definition for the unconventional superconductor, if whenever it is pair breaking sensitive. So therefore, we exclude this state. So then there's the beautiful work by Andrei Pustegov and important follow-up work on this one. We have too many papers on the subject that are all equally important, but the real breakthrough, of course, came with this 2019 Nature paper that told us that a thorough investigation of this material reveals that there is a temperature dependent of the night shift, and this is something that, and more important, maybe there are a couple of follow-up work that makes it more solid, that shows us that we can exclude virtually all of these. I think this is a fair assessment, or maybe you correct me, but this is what I think I interpret into the NMR work that was initiated by this beautiful work and a number of follow-up papers. So we know this is not a triplet, even though many of us, of course, would have loved this to be a PX plus I minus IPY superconductor, but it just ain't. Then, of course, your very, very natural next candidate, because you're breaking time reversal symmetry, would be this candidate. This is an apparent state that is chiral. It breaks time reversal symmetry, and it is in the D channel. It's a singlet. That makes a lot of sense. So again, here we have P plus minus IPY in the letters written like this. Now we multiply this with one odd function, then it becomes an overall even function again. And that is a D wave pairing state. It would break time reversal symmetry, and time reversal symmetry breaking was observed in the system. Actually very near DC at ambient pressure, and then these two transitions split. Even the splitting is what you would have expected for this transition to occur, because the degeneracy between XZ and YZ is of course lifted. By the time you apply strain, and the X direction is different from the Y component. So this is wonderful. It's a very natural candidate. I was always skeptical that this is the right candidate. And the reason was heat capacity work where I was involved with our friends in Dresden. This is the heat capacity as function of strain. This is near ambient strain, TC goes up, and this is the heat capacity jump. You see a wonderful heat capacity jump. And this is the temperature. I don't see a second transition on the heat capacity. So if there are two transitions, superconducting and time reversal symmetry, then there should be two heat capacity anomalies. So you at least can check what would I expect if I have a Ginzburg-Landau description of these two transitions. For the first and the second transitions, heat capacity anomaly. And if this is, and lots of the coefficients that enter the game are dictated by symmetry. So we did this, and this is what you expect. You would generically expect two transitions if it's split. One transition is basically sharing its weight. If this is splitting, it's symmetrical. It doesn't have to be symmetrically the split. It depends on the slope of the TC line. If this lower line gets much steeper, the larger jump you will actually see at the lower temperature. At the higher temperature. Larger jump at the higher temperature, and then the smaller one at the lower temperature. If this is the right behavior, you would see the larger jump at the lower temperature. Remind you what it looks like in the experiment. Oops. In the experiment, you have a more or less constant lower transition and some change in the upper transition. So this is, should be this picture, if anything. So the jump at the lower transition should be bigger. So we should, in this curve here, should see a jump here that is larger than that. So thermodynamically, this time reversal symmetry breaking is just not there. I was always worried about this, but you know, maybe Ginzburg-Landau isn't the right way to think about the problem and so forth. So 5%, they say. 5% of this jump. I think my eye can tell that there is no jump that is three times this jump here. But they make a statement about resolution, and their statement is 5%. So, and again, this is you, if the slopes dictate the ratio, right? So this is, as long as mean field theory, your superconductivity is applicable, this is solid, and it may not be applicable. But I was always worried about this, because I should see something in the heat capacity if there's a phase function. Junior's parameters seem to say nothing, absolutely nothing. Yeah, so you're right. But the data weren't there when this year was published. Yeah, so what else do we have? Then we have the D-wave superconductivity. My colleague Mathieu Decor told me if this was true, this wouldn't be original because we already have a D-wave superconductor, but that is probably not how life works. So there would be the D-wave superconductivity. I went through lengths to have the color code differently. You see, none of them might work here, right? So this is a D-wave superconductor here. That's another option. Then we have something that was proposed by Steve Gibbelson and collaborators. They said maybe there's an accidental degeneracy in the system. That is interesting because we need this to understand the time reversal symmetry. You cannot break time reversal symmetry without having two components, because it's the relative phase of the two components that allows you to even have time reversal symmetry breaking. So therefore, these two were deemed to be natural candidates. This would also explain some elastic constant measurements by Brad Ranshaw. And so therefore, we have now a tool here. We have this elastic caloric effect, the Grünheisen parameter, and the data are there, and here are the data that also includes the superconductors. And I think this is, I mean, gorgeous data. Recent collaboration here with the group in Dresden with Markus Garst and myself, and Yu Sheng Li was the first also. So here we have our map. This is a sign change here. This is the normal state. These are the data I showed you before. Basically, here is one again. It's just the temperature change, not the derivative taken. So we have here our entropy maximum. And you see here there's a line. And if you go below this line, the entropy maximum becomes an entropy minimum. Because now this was a rising curve, below the TC curve that goes down. Yep. Yep. The experimentalist made the statement several times. And I said, if I have a choice, knowing the derivative of a function or just the function, I would always look at the derivative because it has more information, because you integrate and smear. We have calculated entropy in this paper. Most of this was primarily the contribution of Andreas Rost. So we have used these data, integrated it. You need to have one integration constant actually to integrate, but we know the heat capacity at zero strain and can anchor it there, and you get the entropy, and the entropy looks beautiful, and there's a nice maximum of the entropy. So you see all of this, this is what you actually measure, and it's a much more sensitive thing to do. So this is basically the TC. These are the heat capacity data that we knew independently, so this is TC. And so what can we learn? The little calculation we did. Suppose I have a state that has a gap, an antinode, a gap at Siepenhoff point. Well, then the blue curves are the more interesting ones. When I'm right at Siepenhoff point, my VCS singularity gets logarithmically enhanced, but I get a gap. That, if I have a node at the Siepenhoff point, something very interesting happens. Something I didn't know before, if you take the density of states of a superconductor that crosses up an off point, you don't get a gap. You get a gapless superconductor. Only when you tune away from the off point do you get a nodal point. So this is, you get actually a maximum at the density of states of a superconductor at zero energy if you cross the van Hoff point. That's a surprising result, was it to me, but it enabled us to make a statement, namely that the entropy, in one case, from having a maximum at zero at Carnot strain gets a minimum, while in the other case, it keeps having a maximum. So we can, I think, quite confident, and here, this is the quantitative analysis with the tight binding parameters and so forth and so on. So here we see that we can understand that again, the absolute numbers are the ones that we calculate. We can understand that there is the maximum becomes a minimum. We have an entropy quench in the superconducting state. So there must be a gap node at the Van Hoff point. There must be a gap. No node. There must be an anti-node. There must be a gap. This is wrong, right? So in the superconducting state, and what we can then learn is I can look at my table again, and I can exclude everything that we can exclude just based on this one insight that we know now the Van Hoff point must be gapped. And that excludes all of those statements. All these states would have actually a node at the superconducting, at the Van Hoff point. Some of them were already excluded, but some of them weren't yet excluded. In particular, this chiral D-wave state is excluded in my view this way. We can then, we know of course all triplet states are killed. We know that pair breaking is there, and then we have one survivor, and this is a dx squared minus y squared superconductor, and this is at least the only option. Give or take, there is some caveat in the pair breaking story. If I have an S-wave state with lots of sign changing gaps, it could be pair breaking. So we have a story why we, what's the time reverse symmetry breaking is, but I think I'll leave it up there. I tell you that there's an interesting discussion you can have when you have strain. Strain is a powerful tool to, for example, create material that wouldn't exist otherwise, get instabilities that are there just because of the strong coupling between critical degrees of freedom and elastic forces. It is specifically sensitive to disorder. But something that I would not have expected when we went out in this journey, namely that you can even have a serious discussion by these rather bulk thermodynamic considerations, of course, with the help of the knowledge of where we know where the kernel singularity is, that you can identify a pairing state in the system. Thank you so much for your attention.